was an Indian village site, so this would have been, you could work on that cement if you want to. What contest?
Give me a break.
It's your right. It could be used to pounding.
Okay.
No, there's infinite ways.
Do you all want another way of cracking acorns? This is a PVC pipe cutter.
Oh. Does that really work?
I don't know if it's actually any easier.
I think it should be green. Rick told me about that too.
Wow.
Watch your fingers. This is like when you do install pancakes in your spare time, right?
I do. So I figured, it's
so rich.
So that would be bad.
This is really not bad. This is, I mean, that's it's dry. See, that could be a fine layer of mold, but if it's still sound, it's not far apart. I use it. I haven't seen a single one these are all good. I mean, you might have better taste. So look what Tanya and Romy brought. Some pickled acorns. What kind of sauce did you put it in?
It's actually a recipe that walnuts. And so I use their recipe to pickle walnuts. It's an experiment.
They're a little vinegar.
The recipe to pickle walnuts, would you use
acorns
in it? Yeah. I don't know. One of the things, I knew these guys were
about
to land.
I know.
No, it is good, but acorns are very filling. And you can't really eat a whole lot of just acorns.
It's really
when you taste them, it's not bitter. It's a bit of an astringency from the vinegar, but it's not bad at all. You cannot really eat just a meal of acorns. It's just too filling. You cannot do it. You have to, you blend it with something else always.
I've had them for like
almonds? Barbara made that.
Okay.
Start the fire. We'll start cooking some.
Yeah, they smell great.
And we keep our temperature there. So
I would have put it down. That's hilarious.
It works.
Wow.
Of course, man. It works wonderfully.
They would do the same thing. Sometimes they would take something like this. First of all, these are valley or canyonators. They have less tannin. Okay. So you can actually put these just by the fire and let them know.
I just can never figure out how much
crack them open. You can eat your
bread. Not that bad.
No.
It's not.
You can't take anything.
But it's edible.
I think in modern society, we're not even going to taste the edible. Because any sweetener was too bad.
And I read an article too that there's a G that's in about 5-10% of the people that makes bitter just extremely. So they can't, you know what I mean? They just can't.
Look, now what's got these
in the population? Because most foods are starting to fire. To some extent, I suppose those people are just eating out of it. I don't know. Anyway, I was going to say, sometimes they would take something like this and just crack it, just take a rock and boom, and put a whole bunch of them in a little net or under a rock in a stream for a month or two. Even as a whole, kernel, water would eventually reach them. So there's a lot of them.
What about in the ocean? Like
big old acorns. Salt water.
Put them in
an egg
in the ocean and then let the tide wash them?
And preserve
at the same time?
For
salt?
And make
them
a nice salty flavor?
Well, they preserve without it. You don't need the salt.
The tannin keeps these things preserved.
But if you're extracting the tannin.
Why wouldn't it be? Well, it keeps animals from eating except certain
parts. It might be end up some salty.
Yeah. Of course, they would need seaweed. You could use it to season it. You know what I mean? And get protein back.
Paul, do you only gather them off the ground or do you pick them from the tree?
Well, they did it both ways. I live in LA. You know, if you go through the old ethnographic accounts. The problem with the trees is you have to have big long sticks or the young kids would climb up the trees and shake them. That's what they would do. On the ground, the problem is if you don't get them within a fairly short period of time, most of them will have wormholes. You can go out right now and you'll see that. Whereas I got these a month ago, almost none of them, and there were just billions on the ground.
Even. That's pretty late, right?
Yeah, it was pretty late. And it was in the rain, when it was all this rain and everything. Was that about a month ago?
Yeah, December.
Yeah, and oh my God, they were just thick on the ground in real wet, slimy conditions. But you can see, you know, they're nice.
Are there things you can do with a shell?
Firewood.
You can make a...
Just curious, what all you can do with an acorn?
Too many questions.
No, it's good.
Like my son, he just doesn't quit. Except he doesn't give me a chance to give the answer.
Going to the next question.
Well, no, there's a word in my explanation. How did you mean that word? No, I'm
sorry. How did you mean that word?
It's fascinating.
It is. I was just about 2-3 months ago down in northern Baja, in an area where there were, well, there still are a lot of Indians. And they have an acorn down there called emery.
Did you steal them or
something? Deep into the wild area. And it's a small acorn, about that big. But there's very little tannin in it.
Really?
You just crack those and eat them like nuts. And there are billions of them
on the
ground in Baja.
Wow.
And what they would do... Just take those things, put them on a matate or a flat rock, and just pound the hell out of them. Not too much, I should say, pound the hell out. Just smash them gently. And then take that whole bunch, it's all the little peels and everything, and the little cracked kernels and everything, and put it in a pot of water. All of the shell rise to the top. And just pour them on. And then you pour the water off and you leach them a little bit, and it's really enough. Now you just grind it up a little bit into a rough paste and throw it into a bowl and boil it. Soup or mush or whatever consistency.
Yeah, stews and
stuff like that. They would put deer meat in, for example.
And it's a chicken.
Once you leach them, stuff, crushing them and making like a powder, or
yeah,
and like dehydrating it again,
yeah,
and can store that as like a meal, like a powder.
But actually, it's safe to store it just
like this. Yeah.
It may not be all that long and drawn out.
Open granary.
So the wind doesn't always come through and keep them dry.
And I assume they have very heavy. I mean, I know what the tops look like.
But I would assume, too, that they would have plenty there so the water would rain.
But it
doesn't matter much. I left these out in the rain, actually. Because as soon as the rain stopped, they were out.
That's just a superficial.
If you were in Northern California,
try something down here.
Paul, do you have any tips for anyone who wants to bake acorn bread or make tortillas with the flour?
I'm kind of working on that. I mean, I did that recently. It's a pretty rough thing to eat.
Acorn bread?
Yeah. I left too much tannin in it, that's all.
Let me take a picture.
If you don't bake it enough, it's going to have too much moisture. Spoil. If you bake it too much, it just becomes like hardtack. So it's a great survival because you can pack. You can probably pack a month's supply, something like this. You know?
Yeah.
Like do the same. It's so concentrated.
That's what I was asking Paul Campbell, survival expert. Do you?
I love that one bread, but I mean, because I know you always have a certain type of
flour. It's a flatbread, it's a tortilla.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's a tortilla style.
So you can't mix it, because like when you make wheat bread, you have to use some white flour. Can you mix that into the wheat?
Well, you should. You could.
Wheat flour, you can use corn flour instead.
You can do anything. When I was
will it rise okay, or?
It doesn't rise.
It doesn't rise.
You brought your own?
Sometimes they would actually put mud in it. And that leavens it or does something to it. Makes it softer. Or I don't know.
Mud.
Mud. A little mud. A really fine mud that they have. Or clay. We probably call it clay. We should probably call it clay.
So even if I make it like a yeast bread.
Try it. Yeah. Look, you can put anything in flour.
Yeah. You know, you can add any kind of gruel and they don't rise. Number two, if you just use the acorn by itself, it's pretty crumbly. It doesn't hold together because there's no gluten in it.
Because
they're
just wheat. You have to mix it with the white flour and make wheat bread.
Well, they do. I don't suppose you have to. Just to get them, what do they call it? Ash cakes and things. Yeah, that's what it is. Well, but the Indians do too. They just take any kind of grain or anything. You can add some berries and things for flavoring.
Mix it with California buckwheat.
I know, I like making buckwheat.
Make them kind of small. Of course, you would make it small because they are like, he says they're crumbly.
Well, it doesn't take much to fill you up. You get full really quick.
So you'd
I don't think they did bread as much as the other. As
mainly
the
like a flatbread, like bannock or something?
Yeah.
Just you have to grind it into a flour real fine.
That's right. Actually, the rule of thumb is with the really fine flour you could use for bread. The rough stuff, this little lumpy and so forth, makes a good mush.
Mush.
As a rule of thumb.
Like a cereal mush?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they would have that for breakfast. Like grits. Or a light soup if you want to throw in deer meat and you've got a nice soup. It's very nutritious.
I want to take pictures of you.
And it's delicious. I've had the Indians do that for me. Oh, unbelievable. Unbelievable. I mean, just wouldn't think that I've eaten that well. And that was breakfast, too. That was their main breakfast.
If you guys have ever
acorn porridge and deer. Venison.
You used to have a lady do this.
Excellent.
But if you're actually down in Mexico, they're doing it for real, not just for the tour.
Where's that other girl that was here?
I've had tortillas with corn with ground like 20 minutes earlier.
Really?
Yeah, it was awesome.
You see the yellow
sifter,
right?
Yeah.
All the
fine
stuff in that
thin
pan. Hey, you're
doing a good job.
But Indian descent.
You
didn't
way out
of the
river.
Visited a he loved the Indian way. He gathered a lot of these acorns. And his son was got to scoop all by himself. He was alone. But he was fascinated.
Yeah, right.
I have flowers.
And he made spaghetti one day for us. And then used
no,
these
it is. Someone does it to you.
No, it is.
Wow.
So there's an idea.
Wow. What else? I have a friend whose parents, growing up, they never taught them the bad words in Spanish. But when they were going to take it to the next place, they were going to tell you these words. You don't want to hear people say them. We don't want you to say that.
down here if anybody wants to use it, a piece of cement. With an authentic sandstone confirmed by Paul Campbell.
It's survival expert Paul Campbell.
Survival expert Paul Campbell, yeah. Hey, we should put this on film. Come on. Here's a handstone confirmed by author Paul Campbell, we found on site here.
And survival expert.
This is after Paul was pointing out to me how it fits. It fits the left hand. There's a thumb mark. There's degradation here. So if anybody questions it, you talk to Paul. Paul has confirmed this as an authentic Indian handstone. Paul's the author of this book. Right?
Now, what tribe was in this region?
This was the Gibraltar area, or the so-called Tongva. They call themselves Tongva today. Tongva simply meaning the people. Gibraltar was the old name, and that was because of the San Gabriel Mission. Most of them were involved in the San Gabriel Mission. So we're in Oak Grove Park, or Hahamongna Watershed Park. Hahamongna would have been the name of this village site, not the whole group. The group is Tongva. And actually, this is a good book, by the way.
Oh, yeah, I'll definitely get that.
But Paul really doesn't think this is an answer. Paul doesn't always know what he's talking about. So that's going to be on YouTube. Paul Campbell is confirming that that was him.
That's right. Paul's going to love that. Yeah.
That's been an ongoing deal.
Yeah.
Very few modern Indians. I mean, they're like the rest of us, right? They're living modern society.
Yeah.
And they might have retained some kind of vague image of a few things, of course, but they don't have practice skills like that for a long time. But some of the old elders still, the old people still do, and especially in northern Nevada. They're very remote.
Okay.
They don't depend on the modern economy. They still have bows and arrows, crafts, you know, a lot of different things. Know how to process fibers.
Yeah, I need a cordage class.
Yeah.
Cordage is fundamental. Yeah, I'm pretty good at cordage.
I don't even know
if I say so
fire,
myself.
Fire, I don't think.
A lot of things I'm not good at. Fire, I would defer to others.
Really?
You know, if I had to, you know. Christopher. Now, this might just be a fortuitous shape, too. It might not be a real handstone, but this is what they actually look like.
Yeah.
If you found this in an Indian context, you'd say it was definitely used as a handstone, as opposed to that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
They actually purposely square them out over a time. Yeah. As I say, this isn't a great example. pecking. If I took another rock like that one, even, but a harder rock especially. Yeah.
Yeah.
As a practical matter, when you go collect
it, doesn't look that hard to me. This
lot of one or two.
It doesn't look hard at all. But let's just say it was a harder route.
Some are more bitter than
others. You just peck. Same thing with making your matate.
I never do.
You peck out the center a little bit.
What's a matate?
Matate or grinding slab like that, right?
Okay.
See, like, ideally, what they would do with this, you could grind on this, of course. Ideally, they would take a rock and pound out, peck out a little area here so it kind of slopes in.
You could actually use the processor to
if it was just a grinding slab. If it's usually true Mexican style matate, you want to just leave it.
It's really hard.
This motion, I guess, eventually scoops out an area in the middle there.
Relatively fresh, you add water, maybe even soak them.
Mind when you need to grind something, right? Then you flat.
Yeah.
Good. Very good.
I think we use California generally after a time.
This will burn better.
Okay.
Yeah, that's not too bad.
Oh, yeah,
I'm
And everybody cracks them in this case.
Yeah. I already have.
Did you?
Yeah. I didn't finish it.
Some Dutch licorice?
No.
Very salty.
Very salty. I have an idea for anything. What's in this?
I have no idea.
Oh, you have no idea. Okay. Oh, maybe I'm back. Sorry. Ooh, it's really salty. Oh, why would we use salty with this?
It's
just for fun?
I don't know. Dutch people eat it.
Oh, okay. I'm just curious.
And then we have some of the powdering raw. Then we're going to do a different leaching process with that. So you could
it's not quite what you expect from licorice.
I like licorice.
Yeah, me too.
It's pretty salty though.
Have you tried tire tread? I get it at the Whole Foods store. It comes from Austria. No, it's not salty. It's more like your typical black licorice, but it's just delicious.
Yeah.
Very soft.
Okay, look how brown this is.
Yeah, tire tread is awesome.
It's really brown.
What is tire tread?
It's just a brand of...